Hello all here, OS Reviews. You're watching our throwback look at the Sony Ericsson Z250A. This is not a new device. In fact, it came out almost a decade ago in 2007, but one reason why we're taking a look at it now is because I want to make the argument that with the resurgence and kind of continued popularity of some budget-oriented phones which are not smart, but they're meant to fill a specific niche as a backup emergency device or for third world developing countries, getting a slightly older model is actually not such a bad idea after all, especially when on a device like this, all you're really concerned about is making phone calls, maybe sending the occasional text message, and maybe sharing the occasional photo. And for those basic things and basic specs, there's not a huge difference between an older device like this and a newer feature phone. For a phone from 2007, I'm actually quite impressed with how Sony were able to make it relatively compact. Here it is next to a smart flip phone that we did do a review on a few weeks back, and this is a ZTE Android flip phone that has a touchscreen on the inside. You can see how large it is next to it. This fits a lot more comfortably into your hands and into any pockets. It's also not too thick, as you can see here on the side, from a device from 10 years ago. It does use a proprietary Sony charger, which is probably one of the only downsides that I can find from getting an older device, is you'll probably be finding an older Samsung or an older Sony charger, but for the most part, if you're getting a refurbished unit, it shouldn't be too big of a problem. And on the other side, you have access to a dedicated volume rocker, which I always like to see on a device like this, so you can adjust the volume when you're inside a call without having to fiddle around with the D-pad. And there's also a IR/LED light for status on the side here. So ripping open the film that's protecting the surface here, this is a refurbished unit, we have access to an array of notification LEDs on the front. It's one of the more interesting elements of the Z250A. Whenever you get a new call, or if you're playing back a song or getting a new text message, the corresponding LEDs will light up in this kind of retro 8-bit style, which is actually still kind of cool, in my opinion. The phone comes in a few different colors. This is a mocha brown version, and on the top there's a simple VGA/1.3 megapixel camera. There's also access to, on the back, a latch behind the Sony Ericsson logo here that you can pull on to remove the back cover entirely. The back cover is made out of plastic, but it has a soft touch material and grip to it, which makes it pretty comfortable. Now, as aforementioned in another throwback video that we recently did about the Sony Ericsson Satio, one thing I really like about Sony phones of this particular era is they made standard batteries for almost every phone, regardless of model or pricing. So on this phone, we have the same exact BST33 battery, which is a 1000 milliamp hour battery, as we saw on the flagship Sony Satio smartphone. And as a result, on the basic budget device like this, without Wi-Fi, without crazy 4G features, the battery lasts forever. You can use it for weeks and weeks before you need to recharge it again. Behind the battery, we have access to a full-size SIM card slot, and that's pretty much it. So opening it up, the hinge is one of the other interesting elements of this phone. You can see that it almost folds backwards because of the kind of symmetrical latch design going on here. So the screen flips like this, and it gives you a pretty ergonomic angle when you put this next to your ear and this next to your mouth for calling. On the inside, we have a 1.8-inch TFT LCD display, which is capable of showing 65K colors, but it's not very high resolution. With that said, all you're doing is basically viewing back very simple images that you may take with the camera, along with calling people, so it's not really a huge deal. There's also a earpiece for calling, and below that, we just have the Z250A logo. The D-pad of the Z250A is decent. I would say that Sony's D-pads over the years have traditionally been middle of the road. I like their designs. I think that they are pretty futuristic in terms of how they look, but they're often quite flush with the surface of the unit, and that means if you're really rapidly texting and dialing by feel, it doesn't give you as differentiated keys as Nokia's keyboards, for instance, which might be easier to type on very rapidly. Still, the keys themselves are quite large, they're backlit, and it's a traditional T9 layout, which means if you're coming from a smartphone, it's going to take some time to get used to, because alphabetically they're sorted A, B, C, D, E, F, all the way to Z, as opposed to using a QWERTY layout, so you have to kind of hunt and peck, but there is predictive text. There's also a 5-way navigation toggle and an OK key, which is made out of aluminum. Feels pretty decent. There's also two soft keys, a back key, a clear key, and a key that you can tap on to launch into the very basic web browser. It's extremely simple. It's fine for things like a quick Google search, maybe quick news and weather updates, but you don't want to do anything too advanced beyond that. One thing I do like about the design in particular, though, is that they have chamfers on the outer edge of the D-pad. The chamfers are made entirely out of plastic, as you can see here, as opposed to aluminum, like on flagship level smartphones. But there's a very prominent chamfer before it curves off at the sides that reminds me a bit more of a modern device. So pretty forward design from Sony, even though the construction is entirely made out of plastic and it's very light. The display itself is pretty bright, even though viewing angles are a little bit limited, especially if you look at it from the top down, so it doesn't have an IPS panel, but brightness is perfectly acceptable even when you're using it outside, despite the very reflective nature of the panel or the plastic that's covering it up. Really, there aren't too many surprises when it comes to software and performance. There is built-in Bluetooth, but it's mono, so it connects to a Bluetooth headset for answering calls with a mic wirelessly. But it doesn't connect to a stereo headset if you're listening to music, so that's something to point out. Also, the phone doesn't have a memory card slot, so you're probably not going to be storing too much music on it in the first place. But other extras, including some basic Java games, will work if you want to install a few titles like Brick Breaker, for instance, and you can play around with that just to waste a little time. And again, other functions, basic organizers like calculator, calendar, alarm clock are all functional as well. As an unlocked phone, I tried using it with T-Mobile here in the Seattle region, and I was fairly impressed with the overall voice quality. It was clean, the microphone picked up my voice very well, even in outdoor environments, despite the lack of noise cancellation, of course, on such a budget device. So that's more or less it as far as our revisited look at the Z250A, a very budget-oriented flip phone that you can find for under $20. And as a low-cost device, even in 2018, I think that it fits a certain demographic, which is people looking for a backup phone or just people who don't want a smartphone and all of the web-connected apps actually quite well. The design is still quite sleek, I find, even after all these years, which is surprising. And no, this is never going to be an iconic or a device that will replace the powerful smartphone that's sitting in your pockets. But for, again, people on a budget looking for a device without all those functionalities, then really, it's still worth a closer look. You can check out more details about this in the links down below, but for now, that's been our video. Thanks for watching here at OS Reviews. That's been the Sony Ericsson Z250A.